here in person, or perhaps you're online, wherever you are, we hope that this day finds you 1 hour more rested than you were last night. I was in my first senior pastorate, and a senior adult lady of the church invited us for lunch after the day where you spring forward, and she said she was really tired. I said, why is that? She said, well, you know, we lost an hour's sleep last night. I'm just really tired. I said, I feel fine. She said, what's the secret? I said, I went to bed 1 hour earlier. So we're glad you're here today. Beautiful fall day. And this is the time of year when there are a lot of different activities that take place. So if you would, please take note of your bulletin. We won't read all the details to you. But if you would, just look at a couple things. First of all, there will be a permanent change in the hour of prayer. Okay? No longer will we meet on Wednesday evenings. We will now meet Tuesday mornings. That'll be from 10 o'clock to 11:15. Travel for some of our seniors is a challenge at this time of year, and we did this during the summertime. We're just going to make the permanent change, so please make note of that. On Tuesdays from 10 to 11:15, we will have our hour of prayer, and it's been a very enriching time for me. I encourage you to be a part of it because it is so encouraging to me. And we've been working our way slowly but surely through the book of Acts, and we are discovering ways that the New Testament historical writer Luke gives us insights on how we can pray for our church. Also, this special time of year is Veterans Day, and last year we had our first Veterans Day celebration. And the Boy Scouts of America, Troop 8093, were here to help us. They're coming back again this year. That is next Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. So we encourage you to be a part of that service. If you have a family member or a friend who is a veteran, invite them to come with you. We will honor them with some special recognition. Then one other thing in connection with the Boy Scouts being with us next Sunday. This is also the time of year where across the nation, the Boy Scouts collect food. And so we are going to cooperate with them. And next week while they're here, if you would like to join them in their Scouting for Food project, outside, straight out the back, the center doors there, a little bit to the right, you'll see some bags. If you would like to fill that bag with some non-perishable foods, bring them back with you next Sunday. The Boy Scouts will add that to their fundraiser event. At this time, we would like to show a presentation that prepares us for the Samaritan's Purse and our Filling the Box Together. Okay, just be aware that the next 2 weeks we'll be calling for you to be prepared to fill your boxes and the presentation. One thing we're learning about our system is we have one computer right and one computer left, and they sometimes don't want to agree with each other, and that's what we're facing. But we're thankful for Rhonda and Zeke, who are working on this for us, and all the information is back there in the entryway to the right.
When that shoebox is open, they're overjoyed.
You can see them shouting, jumping.
Look at how much they are excited. This is the first time those children are receiving the shoeboxes. They are so happy.
You can hear the laughter. You can hear the cheer. That excitement, it goes and goes and goes.
Right now we're in Ukraine, and today we've given out the 200 millionth shoebox to a little girl here. So it's a lot of fun. It's a privilege for us to be able to come and to help the people as much as we can. Every box is important because every box is an opportunity to tell a child about God's love, about his son, Jesus Christ.
There's so much joy that one gift box can give. They really experience the love of Jesus.
And Operation Christmas Child, we celebrate something as simple as the shoebox because God uses it to share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
We got a full box on 15.
This was such an amazing time. We're so happy to be here. This shoebox gift will impact a child's life all year round.
We never dreamed we'd have an army of men and women who would come to make this program happen.
This is what it's all about, telling others about Jesus.
These shoeboxes go into 120 different countries where pastors and missionaries are going to use them to bring the gospel to kids. So you may think it's just a simple gift at Christmas time, but it's the gift of the gospel, the story of Jesus Christ.
When that shoebox leaves that distribution center and it goes around the world, that's not just one person. That's the body of Christ joined together delivering the good news of the gospel.
They go by plane, they go by ship, they go by riverboat, they go by camels, they go by motorbikes. And these boxes go to some of the most remote areas of the world. And every box counts.
After receiving shoeboxes, children are invited to participate in the Greatest Journey Discipleship Program.
These children have just completed 12 lessons in the Greatest Journey. I believe that discipleship is the key, and they are now followers of Christ. They will tell their friends about Jesus.
My name is Gladys, and I am 9 years old. My friend Kemi told me I needed to go with her to church. I wanted to teach her about the Word of God. And when she came to my church, she received a gift box. For a long time, I asked my mom for a blanket. When I opened my shoebox, I found a blanket in it. When I came home, I showed it to my mom, and she said it was great. I told her about Jesus. Now me, my mom, my grandma, and Kemi go to church together. I am certain of one thing. God is my Savior.
Every box counts. Every box touches a child.
It's like a snowflake. There's not one shoebox that is the same. And we are reaching millions of children with the gospel of Jesus Christ.
If you get the heart of the child, you will reach the heart of the parents, you will reach the heart of the family, and then you will touch the community.
We are seeing churches being planted, and more churches are being built.
We will do whatever it takes to reach the ends of the earth with the gospel.
That gift box is the beginning into their hearts.
Isn't it incredible how these gifts touch the lives of these children? The joy, the smiles, it changes lives. Every year we see tens of thousands of children discipled. And we couldn't do this without you, so thank you for packing the boxes. Thank you for praying for these children around the world. God bless you, and keep packing those boxes.
Peace and quiet.
Peace and quiet.
Now let's pack those Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes.
If you're like me, it can be difficult to know where to start. To make things easier, just start with a box. Any average-sized cardboard or plastic box will work, but I find a shoebox works best. After that, you'll need to decide what age group you're going to pack for, and if it's for a boy or a girl.
Now let's fill that shoebox. It's best to start by selecting a wow item. Something like a soccer ball and a pump. Or a stuffed animal. Something really special.
Yes and yes.
Once you've got your wow item, you can start to fill it with other fun stuff like toys, clothes, sandals, or even school supplies.
What do you mean, however?
However, there are some things you don't want to include. Things like gum, toothpaste, items related to war, liquids. But for a complete list, check out the website.
Oh boy, I think they're gonna like this.
While a shoebox might seem small and simple, it can mean the world to a child who may have never received a gift.
It shows God's love in a tangible way to children in need, and together with the local church worldwide, shares the good news of Jesus Christ. This is why you will also want to personalize your shoebox.
Even including a letter or a photo of your family or yourself can make it extra special to the child.
The most powerful thing you can do is pray. Pray that your gift will make an impact.
That both the child and the community will discover the love and name of Jesus.
When your box is finished, you can make your $10 donation online or by mailing in your contribution using the business reply envelope in the brochure. This donation is critical for training and equipping local churches to share the gospel, along with the collection, processing, and shipping of the shoebox gifts.
And don't forget to activate a label so you can follow your box and discover its final destination.
Finally, make sure to check the website for the closest drop-off location near you.
And make sure to mark the date for the third week in November as National Collection Week.
Well, there you go. You just packed yourself a shoebox. Grandma.
Already done.
What? How? I thought she wasn't going to stores right now.
She isn't. She packed her box online.
That's right, Dad. With just a few clicks of a mouse, Grandma packed her whole shoebox online. She can choose from all kinds of gifts, even make it personal by adding a letter and a photo.
Wow. So she doesn't even need to leave the house.
Nope. She can stay safe inside and still have time for Doomcraft.
Docking complete.
To go to the meeting, the Christmas shoebox meeting in Staunton, and Zeke and Rhonda were out of town, and she asked me if I would go, and it was so interesting. I had no idea, just what they said here at the end, I had no idea that you could purchase a shoebox online. So for $25, you don't have to go to the store, you don't have to do anything. You can do it all online, and that includes the shipping. And so I had no idea about that. But I also wanted to say that I am going to have the privilege for the first year to go to Staunton and help them pack the big semi-trailer that will come for all the shoeboxes that they collect at that collection area. So I'm really excited about that. And the shoebox thing is very near and dear to my heart. And I guess it's because I work with kids all day long, every day. And I see how exciting just little things can be for them. Even our kids. You know, I have this little just nothing toys thing. And they get so excited about it. So I hope that everybody can pack at least one shoebox. Because when you touch that one child, that child's life is changed, and they go back. Just like the video said, she told her mom and her grandma, and now they're all going to church. So you touch more than one life with every shoebox.
Amen. Worship today, I would call our attention to Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. It's a very appropriate verse for this time of year. We've entered the Thanksgiving season. Our society doesn't know what to do with Thanksgiving. They go from Halloween to Christmas. But the month of Thanksgiving and giving thanks permeates Scripture. And for our call to worship throughout this month, may the New Living Translation of Philippians 4:4 be the springboard for everything that we do, not only when we gather for worship, but throughout this month of giving thanks. Paul says, always be full of joy in the Lord. And he says, in case you missed it, I say it again, rejoice. The only way that you can rejoice is if you have joy in the first place. So we want to do that together. Father, we thank you for this time of year. We thank you for the beauty of autumn. The beauty of this time of year in our part of the world, how we see how masterful you are in your artistry. And Lord, our prayer is that throughout this month, throughout the next four Sundays, that you would bless us with reminders of the fact that you are an awesome God, that you have blessed us with not only your presence, but you have blessed us with so many things that we do not deserve. So throughout this worship hour and throughout the month ahead, may we have hearts that are filled with joy, and may we be a people who truly rejoice. In the blessed name of Christ we pray. Amen and amen.
Let's sing. We're going to start with Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord, He is holy and just, by His power we trust in His love. Great is the Lord, He is faithful and true, by His mercy He proves He is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory.
I exalt.
is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Yes, amen.
And if we need a reminder of that, you may be seated if you like while we read the Word of God together. Psalm 23 is a passage of Scripture that, for those of us who've been around the church any length of time, we are very familiar with. But what we are learning as we work our way very slowly and meticulously through the 23rd Psalm in preaching and teaching is that it is rich, and there is a depth to it that goes way beyond what a Hallmark card would say. And today, Psalm 23, we've been reading it from a variety of translations. And today we're going to read from the New International Version, the 2011 edition. And if you would like to follow along in your Bible, whatever translation you have, I'd encourage you to do so. And though you may have been able to say it, recite it, though you may have had it, heard it read for many times and probably have heard many Sunday school lessons and Bible school lessons and sermons preached, may God give us ears to hear in a fresh new way the great truth that's found in Psalm 23. Again, Psalm 23 is a psalm of David, and we read these words, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and your love will follow me all the days of my life. And mark it down, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Rich words. One thing I appreciate about our worship team, they continue to work together, and it's good to hear them practicing. Sometimes they're practicing right in front of all of us. But they found a song that's new to me and perhaps new to you. It's a beautiful song entitled Psalm 23. And they're going to sing it. You join in when you feel comfortable. It is a beautiful rendition of these same words. And if you don't get it today, it's okay, because we'll be in Psalm 23, not only prior to the Christmas Advent season, but even after. Let's sing it together as they teach it to us.
Right beside me all my days.
death. You are on my side. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will shadow of death, you are on my side. Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my
in Psalm 23. This is a mission day. We've already looked at how our involvement through the Samaritan's Purse, Fill a Box, is appropriate and how that's going to touch the lives of children all around the world. Isn't that awesome? And to think that my box might be carried somewhere on a camel was really exciting to me. That's just fantastic. We're not only a part of an international ministry such as Samaritan's Purse, led by Franklin Graham, but we're also a part of the Church of the Nazarene. And the Church of the Nazarene has over 120 areas of ministry. And Ruth, our NMI president, monthly gives us a report on what's happening. And today, she wants to report on what's happening in Jamaica. Jamaica, man. So let's listen to it together, could we?
All right. So my video, my PowerPoint won't play.
I tried to embed a video in it, right? It won't play? Okay. I tried to put a video in it, and I don't know if that was the problem or what, or maybe just because I touched it. So listen, the computer guy at work, he just knows it's going to be me. So I'll just tell you. Okay. So... the motto for this island is called Out of Many, One People. And that's because this nation has been made up of many different nationalities. It evolves from people from Africa, Spain, China, India, Germany, and Syria. Syria was the one that I was surprised about. If you look at the heart up there, that is also the colors of their flag. So the Jamaican flag, the colors in it stand for, the gold stands for the sun, the green stands for the land or agriculture, and the black stands for the creativity of the people. And if anybody knows anything about Jamaica, I would say they're pretty creative. You know, I wanted to wear dreadlocks today, but they cost too much money. The playground lady at our school, she wears dreadlocks. So I asked her where she got them. She said, from Amazon. And I said, well, how many are in the package? Or I said, how much are they? And she said, $30. And I said, well, how many is in the package? And she said, 10. And then I said, oh. I said, that's too expensive. She goes, where are you going to put them in? All that hair? And I said, yes. So just pretend I have dreadlocks. So I had a real cool little map for you. And so Jamaica is an island that's part of the Greater Antilles island set there. And it is 600 miles south of Miami, Florida. So just a very short plane ride from Miami gets you to Jamaica. In 1494, Christopher Columbus discovered the island, and he was so impressed by how beautiful it was that he said it was the fairest island that eyes have beheld. And the Spanish ruled in Jamaica until 1655 when the British came and conquered it. The British seized it in 1655, and they ruled it for 3 centuries. And during that time, they were not going to just let all this wonderful land just lay there. So they established a plantation economy. So basically, they enslaved about 250,000 people to work the land and make money for Britain. And they did that until 1834, when slavery was abolished. So they further tried to distance themselves from the British rule. And in 1958, they joined something that was called the Federation of the West Indies. And they that was a lot of the British colony islands and things formed this federation just to kind of start to try to rule themselves in a little bit. So then in 1962, Jamaica finally even left the federation for their complete independence. That was in 1962. That was after the wonderful year of 1961 when I was born. So just so you know, the year later. So just a little bit of statistics. The population in Jamaica is 2.83 million. And that is actually a decrease from 2022 by 3,228 people. So COVID kind of really did its business on a lot of these countries. 45% of the population is under the age of 25. Almost half of that country is under 25. That was amazing to me. So enter the church, 1966. Church of the Nazarene came to Jamaica. And the Great Commission is alive and well in Jamaica. The Church of the Nazarene continues to make a concerted effort to win souls for Christ through evangelism. Church members are trained and provided opportunities to apply their learning at the local church level. Churches have conducted outreach through crusades that include distributing tracts in casual walks through communities, prayer walks focused on the needs of communities, and one-to-one witnessing. And then I had this wonderful picture that I took off of the little website that I get all my information. And it's this woman. She's standing behind this huge pot outside, huge pot. And you see her putting some things in to this pot. And one of the initiatives that one of the churches has in Jamaica is called Saturday Soup and Praise. So she has got this huge cauldron of soup going. And so for soup and Saturday Soup and Praise, the soup is taken to people who are unable to get out of their homes because of health problems. And because of this, they have started building such strong relationships with families that five people have already come to know Christ. So that doesn't seem like a lot, 5 people, but remember the shoebox. 1 child who touches their family, and then their family can touch other families. So these 5 people, even though they sound like they're homebound, they have families. So 5 people, but it can go on and on and on. So the Lord can bless it. So then my slide says, bring in the kids. So since the population is so young, the church naturally focuses on some children's and youth ministries. And out of the children and youth ministry. They call them children's fun days. 25 kids have been saved through these fun days. And Sunday school teachers are specifically trained to evangelize to kids. And through that evangelism, kids are taught that they are evangelists also. So they can see themselves as going out and evangelizing people. So for the numbers people, there are 3,354 members. A lot better than Egypt, right? 34 fully organized churches. Let me get my papers turned here. 12 district licensed and 19 ordained ministers on two districts. Okay, so there are the facts. Now, let's do a little trivia. What is the official language of Jamaica? Una, shout it out. What? What'd he say? Reggae? Jamaican. Hey, that makes sense to me, right? English. English is the official language of, now I got to tell you a funny story. I was at the gym one time working out, and my sister was there, and her and I were chatting. There was a lady right here. She was four, and I found out later. But my sister and I are talking, and she finally says to me, "Excuse me, what language are you speaking?" English. I realize I have my own version, but it is English. So I'm sure, like me, the Jamaicans have their own version of English, but that's okay. Okay, next question. Jamaica is located in, and here are your choices, North America, Europe, Australia, or Asia? Shout it out. Yes, in the back. She says North America. Do you agree? She's right. North America. North America. That's right. And we had this all, Chucky helped me, and we had this. This was awesome looking. Too bad it doesn't. Oh, now this one is going to be easy. All right. Take down the thing. Okay. What color is not in the flag? Red, gold, black, or green? Red. 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 And then I had this really cool little clip. Who remembers something that was totally unique about Jamaica that happened in 1988 Olympics? In the Olympics. Jamaica. What? The bobsled. Yeah. Who remembers the, what was his name? John Candy movie, Cool Runnings. I got to watch that again after watching these clips. I got to tell you. In 1988, Jamaica sent a bobsled team. Now, this is, you know, no snow in Jamaica. They send a bobsled team to Calgary. I said Calgary yesterday, too. Calgary, Ontario, for the Olympics. I think they finished like 31st out of 41. But the fact that, and they crashed. Do you remember that? They crashed. And in my little clip, it was John Candy telling them about, your bones, they see this crash. No, your bones don't break on, a crash on a bobsled. They shatter. So you might want to watch that. That was a cute movie. Okay, so today I'm going to have a little taste of Jamaica, and I had a picture of this also. One of their favorite desserts is very simple, very strange, but it is grapefruit with sweetened condensed milk. So I will have a little bit of that for you to try at the end of the service. So I hope that you. Okay. Yeah, I made Chuck and Linda and Mark and Anna taste it. So I think I tasted it, but I don't like grapefruit. So, but thank you, Pastor, and thank you guys for just listening to me. It's a lot better when there's slides. But
amen. Thank you, Ruth. Thank you very much. As we prepare our hearts for prayer, as we typically do on our Mission Moments Day, we are going to pray specifically for Jamaica. And this is a time of open altar, and we're going to stand together in just a moment, and we're going to sing the chorus, Gentle Shepherd. And it is a time of open altar. Perhaps you would like to pray for the people of Jamaica. You have a great interest in young people, and you may want to come and represent some young persons, children or youth, who are part of the ministries of the Church of the Nazarene there. Or if you like soup on Saturdays, you may want to pray for that one individual who every Saturday is giving soup and sharing the good news of Jesus. We also have our own needs. It is a time of open altar. As we sing this chorus together, feel free to respond as you feel led of the Lord. Let's stand together, could we? Heavenly Father, we've gone to extreme measures of praise as we began our hour together today. And we've heard of how you are working around the world, and now we pause in a very solemn and reflective tone. We pray that you, gentle shepherd, would lead us and that you would feed us. We're truly grateful for the fact that you are a God who loves all people, red and yellow, black and white. We're grateful for the fact that in our world of division, you love Jews and Gentiles. You love Palestinians and Israelis. You love those who are following you, and you also love those who have yet to begin following you. You are truly a God who loves all people, and we give you thanks today for that reality. And so today we pray specifically. First of all, we pray for the Samaritan's Purse. We pray, we'll be laying hands on all the boxes that will be coming in 2 weeks. But we just pray right now that you would do your work ahead of time. Bless every hand of this local church who'll be packing boxes. We pray that you would bless every person who's going to deliver the boxes, every ship, every train, every camel that's going to deliver the boxes. Lord, you are an all-powerful, all-knowing God, and so you just bless this ministry as only you can. And then, Lord, we also pray for the nation of Jamaica. We pray that the 25 and under crowd, who makes the 46% of that local congregation, that local population, our prayer is that they would experience Jesus Christ. We know that that's a very vulnerable age, and our world works hard of dissuading and distracting the people of the younger crowd. And we pray right now for the leaders of the Church of the Nazarene who are there in Jamaica. We pray that as they reach out to the young younger generation, that you would give them wisdom beyond themselves. And Lord, we pray that the relationships that we heard about being established through soup and praise Saturday, Lord, may that be multiplied over and over again. And may it not only be multiplied in Jamaica, may it be multiplied in the Church of Jesus Christ all around the world, including Glen Carbon. Lord, we realize that we live in a divided world. We live in a world where people just continue to separate themselves from any kind of relationships. Lord, our prayer is that your Holy Spirit would fill us, that your Holy Spirit would transform us, and that we would be truly the living examples of the God of peace, who, according to the book of Ephesians, takes two extreme belief systems and two extreme attitudes toward life and brings them together, makes them one. We realize that in a divided world in which we live, it's only through the peace of Jesus Christ that two can become one. And Lord, we do pray for our own congregation. We pray for the different needs that are a part of our gathering. We know that there have been requests made during the Sunday school hour and through the week as we've interacted via telephone calls or having lunch together. We just pray that all the needs that are represented by this local church, that you would meet them as only you can. And Lord, may you truly be the gentle shepherd who leads us and who feeds us. We thank you for the promises of your word. And as we continue to look deeply into a part of your word, may your kingdom come. And may your will be done in our lives, just as it is in heaven. We pray these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and our Savior, and all the people of God said, amen and amen. Thank you so much. As the children are dismissed to Children's Church in the construction zone, I hope that you have your Bibles handy, whether they be in a book form or on an app on your phone, whatever format that you have the Word of God. My hope is that you will take it and that you will follow along as we once again enter into the opening verses of Psalm 23. One of the things that we hear when we approach people about the truth of God's Word, sometimes we hear something like this: well, how can that be worth anything? Those are words that were expressed 2,000 years ago. Jesus Christ, he came to this earth and he ministered and he died. And yeah, if he was resurrected, that was 2,000 years ago. So what could that have to do with today? As you come to the 23rd Psalm, we read there in the superscription that it is penned by David. And as we look at the historical record, David lived 3,000 years ago. The truth is, some would say, the truth is, you know, David lived in a palace. But you know what? That palace is gone. David was a great musician. It tells us that he played the harp beautifully. In fact, he calmed a distracted and upset King Saul through playing the harp. But that's harp. It's gone. Well, he was a student of the Word. He most likely had a copy of the law. Well, he may have read the copy of the law and he may have meditated on it, but you know what? It's gone. What could that say to, what could the Bible say to us? Words that were expressed and report on things that took place hundreds and hundreds of years ago. But friends, I would like for us to realize that when we come to Psalm 23, it's as fresh today as the hour in which David initially composed it. The truth is, the Shepherd Psalm has an unending relevance. Think about it. Some of the first words that a child memorizes in Sunday school are what? Psalm 23. Often the last words from God's word that are whispered when life ends is Psalm 23. As I reflected on the number of funerals and celebrations of life that I've had the opportunity to lead and to minister to families, there's one passage of scripture that's been asked to be read more often than not. The family requests that they, when their loved one is celebrated, that the shepherd's psalm be read. The truth is, from the believer's earliest and final years, Psalm 23 speaks. It speaks to those who are suffering in a hospital, facing a serious situation. It speaks to the soldier stationed at a lonely, isolated post. It speaks to the people of God who are burdened down with a heavy load of care. Psalm 23 provides strength when we are at our weakest. Psalm 23 has been described as a lullaby for our fears. And what holds this psalm together is the very first line. The Lord is my shepherd. Don't forget the little two-letter word that introduces it. It's the word if. And what we have to realize is the truth that's expressed throughout this psalm is built on the fact not that we believe that the Lord is a shepherd that we can choose to follow, among many other things that we can choose to follow. It's the truth of if the Lord is my shepherd, I will never lack anything. I'm reminded of the story that a little girl, she was part of one of those Sunday school classes that was memorizing the 23rd Psalm. And when she stood before her teacher and was going to quote it, she said, "The Lord is my shepherd, he is all I want." Now, she may not have been correct by what she said, but the truth is, she interprets Psalm 23, verse 1, precisely. It catches the heart of what Psalm 23 teaches. It teaches us not only about the beginning of life and the ending of life, it teaches about all of life in between the beginning and the ending. It teaches us about a life of faith. If the Lord is my shepherd, I will not lack anything. And if we stop there, we will get caught in the trap that he will give us exactly what we want. Don't stop there. Because as you go to verse number 2, he begins to articulate what we experience, what we will always have available to us when the Lord is our shepherd. We have rest. I don't have to remind you that we live in a hectic, hurried, and harassed age. We find it seemingly impossible to rest. There have been several times in my preaching and teaching ministry where I've been interacting with people prior to or after a service of teaching and preaching. And I discover that some of them have just returned from vacation. And I've heard on several occasions these words, "I'm so glad to get back to work so I can get some rest." Wait a minute! That just doesn't seem to add up. We live in a hectic, hurried, harassed age. And the truth is, many of us would like to stop in the maddening pace, cease running in circles, quit wearing ourselves out. But if we were honest, we fear taking time out I heard my wife say this on more than one occasion during her 32 plus years of teaching. She would often report to school rather than calling in a substitute because there was so much prep time to get ready for the substitute, and the substitute most likely wouldn't carry through with everything that was left, that it required more time, more energy, and it just wasn't worth it to take the time of rest. The truth is, oftentimes, we fear taking time out because we believe that if we take time out, it will be so difficult to catch up that taking time out is not worth the trouble. And in Psalm 23, David, who has keen insight into the human way of thinking, he uses this picture of a shepherd and sheep relationship, and he uses it to bring out the subject of time out and rest. Now, we must keep in mind that from the world's perspective, that sheep are not considered some of the brightest animals on the face of the earth. As I researched this passage, I went to a thesaurus and tried to find a list of adjectives associated with the word sheep. Here's what I found: ordinary, stupid, lost, dirty yellow gray, unimpressed, commonplace, erratic, ornery, days, passive, wayward, timid, and slow. Sheep don't have a very good reputation. And it's interesting that as we do more research into the topic of shepherding, especially shepherding in the era in which David not only lived, but in the era in which he was a shepherd and herded his father's sheep, they tell us that sheep don't know when or how to rest. It's one of the key responsibilities of the shepherd. Perhaps the flock is facing a long, difficult journey to the next green pasture. The next grazing area is going to take quite a while to reach. And so, as the shepherd anticipates that, he gets the flock and he settles them down because they need rest. And the shepherd works maybe a few minutes, but maybe for a couple of hours, to get the animals calmed down and settled. Until they are calmed down and settled, they won't truly rest. Then they tell us that something could frighten the calm, settled flock. Could be the growl of a wild animal close by. It could be the bark of a dog. It could be the shout of a human. But whatever it is, the sheep become instantly anxious. And so instead of laying back, resting, you know what they do? They jump to their feet and they begin to pace back and forth. Back and forth. You get the picture? The shepherd realizes that the flock needs rest, but something has disturbed the peace. Something has frightened them. And so rather than resting, they become agitated and they jump to their feet and they begin to pace. Desperately needing rest, ironically, the sheep are wearing themselves out even more. Now, please, I already noted the shepherd realizes that the flock needs rest. And my friends, what is true of the shepherd that is described in David's 23rd Psalm is a truth for us, the sheep of God's pasture today. We live in a hectic, hurried, harassed world. And the truth is, we can become a hectic, hurried, harassed sheep. And what is really interesting, did you notice we've said it many times? Look at verse 2. It says, he doesn't lead us to the paths that are green. But as he leads us to those paths, what does the shepherd do? He makes us lie down. Don't read past that. The number one priority, the number one desire of the great shepherd is rest for the sheep. Now, typically for most of us, we think of rest as a physical rest, which is appropriate. But this is talking about the Lord of my life. This is talking about something that's taking place deep within our being. And the greatest desire of the shepherd himself, the greatest desire of God the Father, the greatest desire of his Son Jesus Christ, the greatest desire of the Holy Spirit is that you and I have lives of rest. Not only physical rest, but spiritual rest. And that spiritual rest that we are talking about is only found through Jesus Christ. You say, that's an Old Testament passage, Pastor. I'm glad you brought that up. It's also a New Testament passage. And for the final few minutes, I hope that you'll turn to a couple New Testament passages and look at the teachings of the New Testament, Jesus, and also the writer to the Hebrew of the Hebrew letter, to discover what the New Testament tells us about the rest that God wants for his people. The first one is found in Matthew chapter 11. Now we, along with those memory verses of Psalm 23 that we may have learned, we also may have quoted the last two or three verses of chapter 11 of Matthew, which talks about rest. But to really get the impact of what is stated in those final verses, let me walk with you through several verses. We won't read them all. I'm just going to highlight them to you. And if you want to make note, it'd be great. If you want to check me out, go for it. And see if I've told the truth and whole truth and nothing but the truth. Matthew chapter 11 begins with the description that John the Baptist is in prison. And as he is in prison, this person of God sends his followers to ask, Jesus, are you the Messiah? Now, some of us would say, well, how could he question that after what he's seen and what he's experienced? Well, we've all been there, haven't we? There come those things in our lives. Maybe we've never been thrown in prison, but we face situations in our lives like John, where it's like, this thing just doesn't seem to be coming together like I thought it would. And so he asks, are you really the Messiah? And Jesus tells John's disciples to just tell them what you've seen and what you've heard. Then it moves into verses 7 through 15, and Jesus goes and no longer addressing John's disciples, but in verse 7 through 15, he talks to the crowds about John the Baptist. And he says, even though he's had this question, and even though right now he's in prison, and even though right now he's struggling with how this kingdom is all going to fit together, I want you to know something. He's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Verse 16 through 19, Jesus goes on to point out that many of the current generation are missing the kingdom of heaven. Notice how he's gone from John to a statement about, you know what? Let's think about our own generation. Let's think about the crowd who are gathered here right now listening to me. And the truth is, many are missing the reality of the kingdom of God. In fact, verse 17, he's not very nice when he says, in fact, most of the people are like spoiled little children. And he goes on and actually accuses genuine kingdom leaders of carrying out the work of the evil one. In fact, he is so distressed by how many are spoiled children and how many are being led astray by these false ideas. Verse 20 through 24, he says, woe! Woe to those who refuse to hear. Woe to those who refuse to see. Woe to anyone who does not respond to the true kingdom of heaven. And he keeps building. In verse 27, he says, you know what? Let's get to the bottom line. If you want to know the Father, you got to know the Son. If you want to know the way to the Heavenly Father, you got to have the way to me. In verse 27, if you know the Father, you'll know the Son. And what he is addressing are some of those leaders, those spiritual leaders who are teaching that you better keep on working hard, keep on seeking to follow the law, both the written law and our interpretations of that law. You keep carrying the burden of religion. And he goes on to say, what I want you to understand, you will never experience rest by continually involving yourselves in the heaviness and the burdens of the law. You can't work yourselves into eternal rest. You've got to know the Father. And if you know the Son, you will know the Father. And that's how we experience the rest of the kingdom of God. Amen. Yes. Knowing the rest of the Father includes verse 29, learning more and more about Jesus. And all the people of God said, amen. I wish we would. Learning more and more about Jesus deepens the rest relationship. Deepening our relationship with Jesus by learning about him deepens our relationship with the Father. And as our relationship with the Father deepens, we have rest for our souls. Verse 30, he talks about companionship with himself. Jesus says, get in the yoke with me. See, the yoke of religion is burdensome. It makes you weary. We think we need a vacation, but we come back and we're more tired. No, he says, if you get into my yoke is easy. It fits just right. You see, when we are linked to Jesus, we move in unison with him. We move together. And rather than burdensome, wearing yoke, we have a yoke that fits, it's serviceable, it's useful, it's advantageous. And he says it's a light burden. When you think of following Jesus Christ, if your mind goes to another burden, please, you're missing it. When we're in the yoke with Jesus, it fits. It's easy. When linked to Jesus, we move in step with Jesus Christ. When we are in the yoke with Jesus, there may be a burden, but it's light. It's easy to bear. It's not burdensome. We may have a burden, but we are able to continue with the burden. Why? Because we are linked with Jesus Christ. Well, that's Jesus. That's just one passage. Oh, you want another one? Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 4. I hope I hear some pages or some devices clicking. Hebrews chapter 4. A couple of weeks ago, we looked at this passage briefly. We want to look at it more closely here this morning. If you have a New International Version, you'll see that the editors have entitled this section, A Sabbath Rest for the People of God. And again, when we think of a Sabbath rest, we think in terms of doing absolutely nothing on one day a week. That's an Old Testament concept. See, in the Old Testament, rest was outward focus. We need physical rest. Now, contained in it was the reality of the fact that when you take physical rest, a day of rest, you are refueled spiritually. But the New Testament teaches we live 24/7 in this attitude of rest. We have this faith, this confidence in Jesus Christ that impacts every moment of every day. So Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1, we will read some of these verses. It's not quite as long. But you'll notice he says, therefore, in light of what I've said about unbelief, he says, therefore, since the promise of entering the rest still stands. In other words, to enter into the rest of God that's taught in the New Testament, it's available to you and you and you and you and me. It's out there. It's available to us. Verse 1 goes on, but be careful. Be careful that none of us miss it. Well, how could we miss it? Or how can I be sure? How can I have this security? How can I function in the reality of this 24/7 attitude of resting, trusting in God's provision? That He will give me everything I need, and His main concern is that I have this rest, spiritual rest. Well, look at verse number 2. He says, don't fall short of verse 1 because we also have had the good news proclaimed to us just as they did. Talking about the people of Israel, and as they, when they missed it, they had the opportunity to cross the Jordan into the promised land, but they refused to believe. They could have entered the promised land. They could have entered into the provision of God there in Palestine as they crossed the Jordan River, but they chose not to believe. And it says there, verse 2, the message they heard was of no value. Why? Because they did not share the faith with those who obeyed. The rest is available to all of us, but it has no value if we do not respond in faithful obedience. Amen. Yeah. Verse 3 goes on to say, now we who have believed enter that rest, just as God has said, so I declared on oath in my anger, they shall never enter my rest, and yet His works have been finished since the creation of the world. If you believe, you will enter into the rest. You saw how I was disappointed in the prior generation, but I am a gracious, loving Lord, and I'm not only living in the Old Testament realm of the law, I'm living in the New Testament revelation of Jesus Christ, and He is available to all of us in this restful lifestyle is available if you will receive it, amen, if you will believe it. Right. Now, surely anyone would want to enter that. Well, verse 6a, it says, well, the fact is it still remains for some to enter that rest, but they haven't done it. They just refuse to enter. They still need to enter that rest. Oh, by the way, this is to a Jesus-believing group of Hebrews. He's not addressing pagans. He's not addressing people who've never heard the message of Christ. This is a letter to the Church of Jesus Christ, the Jewish congregation, most likely there in the city of Rome. He said, you have heard the good news. And what he says there, as you once again hear the good news, verse number 7, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your heart. You mean if I don't choose to respond, my heart grows more hardened? If I choose not to respond in belief in faithful obedience, verse 11. We'll miss it. Verse 11, if not, one will perish because of following the example of disobedience. Notice how we've come full circle. I need a vacation. I need physical rest. That's true. Likely you do. But what do we do when we have a time of physical rest? Do we renew ourselves spiritually? When we're on vacation, rather than going to church, we skip church. When I get a day off, do I invest it in the scriptures? Or do I bury myself in temporal things? See, here's the bottom line. Well, it took you long enough, been 30 minutes. I wanted to get the scriptural perspective. The biblical bottom line truth is this. The shepherd's rest is found in this way. God speaks, God moves, or God nods in my direction, and I respond. God speaks, God moves, or he nods in my direction, and I respond affirmatively. Rabbi Zacharias wrote the book titled Jesus Among Other Gods. And in that book, he tells a story about how God, the master weaver, sovereignly works to weave beauty into lives as we respond to God's will. During a trip to India, Zacharias noticed a father and son who were weaving some of the most beautiful Indian wedding saris in the world. Zacharias explains the background and then describes the scene, and I quote, "The sari, of course, is the garment worn by Indian women. It's usually 6 yards long. Wedding saris are a work of art. They are rich in gold and silver threads, resplendent with an array of colors. The place that I was visiting was known for making the best wedding saris in the world. I expected to see some elaborate system of machines and designs that would boggle the mind. Not so. Each sari was being made individually by father and son team. The father sat above on the platform, 2 or 3 feet higher than the son, surrounded by several spools of thread, some dark, some shining. The son did one thing. When the father nodded in his direction, the son would move the shuttle from one side to the other and back again. The father would gather some threads in his fingers, nod once more, and the son would move the shuttle again. This was repeated for hundreds of hours. Till you see a significant, magnificent pattern beginning to emerge. The son had the easy task. Simply move at the father's nod. All along, the father had the design in mind and brought the threads together. Zacharias ends with these words. The more I reflect on my own life and study the lives of others, I am fascinated to see the design God has for each one of us if we would only respond to him when he speaks, when he moves, when he nods in our direction. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack anything. And the most important thing that I need is rest. Father, we make faith such a challenging thing. But your scriptures give us pictures and give us challenges that unfold for us the reality that though we may want to make faith issues very difficult and tie knots that seemingly can't be untied, but we try to come up with reasons and excuses, we really begin to realize that scripture is pretty simple, that when you are our shepherd, we have everything we need. And Lord, I pray that you would teach us to be responded to you. And when you call us to lie down in green pastures, may we not fight you. Father, if we were honest today, we've been fighting your call, trying to get us and seeking to make us to lie down in green pastures. We've been fighting you for years. We've been hanging on. That one thing, that one person. We've been hanging on. Every time we think we're settled in, there's that loud noise that causes us to jump up and begin to pace back and forward. Lord, I pray today the genuine revival, the genuine movement of the great shepherd would take place in Glen Garvin. And Lord, we can pray that it would happen in our community and in our cities and counties. But we realize that if it's not happening in us, the people of God, we should never expect it to happen among those who have no idea what it is to follow the Lord as a shepherd. So continue to speak to us. Continue to nod in our direction. And Lord, may we have the courage to simply trust. Give us the ability to move when you say move. Give us the ability to wait on you rather than trying to pull all the strings, pull all the right levers, making our lives peaceful. We realize that Jesus Christ, according to Isaiah's prophecy, is the Prince of Peace. And I pray that Matthew chapter 11 may not be the description of our life. May we get in on the yoke of life with Jesus. Hebrews chapter 4, Lord, please give us the grace to say yes, to respond, and help us to come to terms with the reality that when we don't respond, our hearts become another level of being hard. As we close, Lord, our benedictory prayer is, gentle shepherd, just come and come and lead us. Come and feed us. Please come and help us find our way. And Lord, as I focused today, as we focused today, as I focused on this verse throughout this week, I realize to help us find our way, that if we're in the yoke with you, Jesus, that our is referring to you as Lord and us as your sheep. So for our benedictory prayer, I ask you, congregation, if you would, just very quietly and very reverently, sing this chorus together again. And as the Spirit speaks, as Jesus nods in your direction, as the Heavenly Father kind of taps you gently on your heart, Just respond to him. Say yes to him. Let's sing it together. Back there.